Hello everyone, I'm Arin and I would be presenting the final presentation for Group 21 and our project name is Vagbox. Giving you a brief overview of our project, we try to solve the problem faced by people in underdeveloped countries, especially sub-Saharan Africa, where the lack of storage and transport technologies with temperature control facilities is becoming a barrier in using vaccines like Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine that require a temperature profile to be maintained between minus 60 to minus 80 degrees Celsius. The solution we propose is to analyze various materials and procedures available and making a passive storage vaccine box using thermal insulation methods. We analyzed our solution by using 1D heat transfer equations and found analytical solutions to produce valuable results. Our broad aim is to provide a long-lasting solution to the last mile temperature control facility problem so that the vaccines could be administered into isolated and rural areas within these countries. And through our project, we successfully calculate the time for which our proposed product is able to maintain an optimum temperature required by this Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine. Now, to know some statistics and literature that will make it clear why we chose this particular problem in specific and the following solution. Less than 2% of world's COVID vaccines have been administered in Africa till now. And one of the reasons behind this is the lack of cold storage and transport chain for some type of vaccines. While vaccines like Moderna, AstraZeneca, and Covaxins are vaccines which have an available efficient storage cum transport system in these countries, as they don't require a sub-zero temperature to be maintained at all times of transport and storage, especially the last mile. While these underdeveloped countries have been receiving the Pfizer vaccine till now only through the limited Covax facilities in place, while countries like India have liberalized vaccine acquisition for states. There's a big challenge in vaccinating people living in places lacking reliable electricity and other basic facilities. The vaccination numbers are even worse in rural isolated areas, lacking direct connectivity with big cities. Through research of different materials, we also came across dry ice, which has a very low sublimation temperature of minus 78.5 degrees Celsius and is an efficient coolant which could be incorporated in our vaccine box to maintain Pfizer vaccine at its optimum temperature. Now, moving on to the product design of our vaccine box. This is a 3D model of a small vaccine box. It is capable of transporting some vials of vaccine, specially used for last mile delivery, while taking vaccines directly to the people where it needs to be administered, especially living in places which are remote or rural areas. This is a multi-layered vaccine box made up of thermally insulating materials, which have low radiative heat transfer coefficients as well as other convective and conductive heat transfer coefficients are also lower and are useful for thermal insulation. Interaction of this box is with air, and while transporting in small vehicles for the last mile delivery, these would be carried by frontline workers to these areas to carry out vaccination programs and saving lives. Diving into the detailed view of this box, it has four layers of materials composing of an outermost vacuum insulated panel, two styrofoam layers keeping the coolant layer intact in between them and preventing it to come in contact with the innermost core of this box, which is the place where the vaccines will be stored at the optimum temperature. Now, moving on to the possible modes of heat transfer in our case, the first possible mode of heat transfer is convection of heat from air to vacuum panels. The other mode considered is convection between styrofoam layers due to carbon dioxide, which is produced when our coolant dry ice sublimates after a particular point of time. The third possible mode of heat transfer is conduction through various layers of insulation and dry ice while it's solid. And the last mode of heat transfer is radiation from atmosphere and outside walls of the vehicle to vacuum panels. The last mode of heat transfer is considered to be negligible and is proved further in detail. Moving on to the control volume analysis of our case, the ambient temperature outside is considered to be 43 degrees Celsius, which is a good temperature to test the cold storage ability and facility of our box as it matches with the temperature observed during hot days in such tropical regions. Moving on to the vacuum insulated panels, they are initially assumed to be at 20 degrees Celsius, which we believe is a nearly room temperature in which empty storage boxes will be kept initially. The coolant dry ice inserted as a solid at its sublimation temperature is initially maintained at minus 78.5 degrees Celsius. The inside is the core of the box. And now we move towards the technical problem for our overall control volume calculation and estimation. So we use the following overall heat balance equation, which tells us that the overall change in heat transfer is equal to heat transfer due to radiation plus convection and conduction. The problem that we have in hand is we take Pfizer-BioNTech vaccine at minus 80 degrees Celsius, which is the lowermost optimum temperature of the vaccine. And we are calculating the time taken for the inner core to go outside the optimum temperature range, that is above minus 60 degrees Celsius. Now, moving on to the estimation of heat transfer mode for the overall control volume balance. As in the overall control volume analysis, we see that we don't have any solid-to-solid contact between layers, as all the vacuum-insulated panel and other layers are apart inside the control volume. So the conduction is zero when interacting and checking heat transfer with them. The heat transfer modes possible are left with convection and radiation. The convective heat transfer rate can be calculated by the following formula, in which we need to calculate the convective heat transfer coefficient of air, which is calculated using Rayleigh number and Nusselt number correlations for overall control volume conditions, and which is found to be 2.3846. Putting its value in the equation and the temperature difference, we get that convective heat transfer rate is 0.93 watt. And similarly, calculating the radiative heat transfer rate by knowing all the values of the coefficients and using properties of our vacuum insulated panels, the outermost layer of the box, we get Q radiation is equal to 0.05486 watt. The conclusion from this calculation is that convective heat transfer rate is much larger than the radiative heat transfer rate in the overall control volume calculation, helping our initial assumption that radiation heat transfer could be neglected. Moving on, we move to the technical problem definition. So this is a technical problem defined. Initial conditions have already been defined for the vaccine and the vacuum insulated panels. So we also assume the styrofoam layers, which wraps the dry ice basically in the vaccine box, to be at the same temperature as the dry ice initially, that is minus 78.5 degrees Celsius for easier calculations. This is a diagram of exact values of distances in centimeter of what our dimensions of a vaccine box would look like. The innermost core would contain the vaccine, and our aim is to find the time after which the vaccine crosses the optimum temperature limit. So to calculate the time, we move forward to first of all see what our qualitative temperature profile would look like in our problem. The first image shows you a GIF of how in a 3D simulation, the temperature varies through across layers. It's 1/4 part of a box simulated over 10,000 seconds, which shows you the variation of temperature qualitatively. The other figure shows you an estimate of how temperature would vary inside the layers and a rough graph of how temperature varies linearly within these layers, which is one of our simplifying assumptions, and how temperature varies outside considering a free convection situation. Over to Anuj to move into the deeper details and conclusion of our project.
Thank you, Aryan. Now we'll move forward to looking at the heat balance across the control volume of our model. So as you know, the change of energy stored with time can be taken to be the energy coming inside a system minus the energy going outside plus the energy generated. As we know, this system of ours isn't generating any energy from inside, nor is any energy going out. So the final equation turns out to be dQ by dt is energy inside, which is in the form of three heat transfer modes, that is radiation, convection, and condition. We neglected work again because there is no work done by the system. So we end up with a equation which is mcp dt by dt equals to q convection or q conduction, depending on what which is applicable where. So when we start looking into the parameters of our model, we have defined various temperatures at each layer of the model and the lengths of various layers. The material properties are also given to aid calculations. So we have two parts to our problem. One is to find the time required for the dry ice in this layer to sublimate completely so that it becomes carbon dioxide. And that is the first part. The second part is to find out the temperature for the vaccine to drop from minus 80 to minus 60. So we'll use lumped capacitance model and take all these layers as various resistances using in the model. Initially, we'll study T1, T2, and T3 to find the time required for the dry ice to melt. Once we convert it into carbon dioxide, we can analyze all other the other two layers to reach the vaccine. So let's do it one by one. So for the initial temperatures, we use the transient conduction equations for T1 and T2, thus getting the heat transferred and the heat flux of the same. So while solving this in using analytical tools, we get the variation of T1 with time. We found out that the temperature T1 changes from 41.1 to 41.7 in around 8,000 seconds, which is not much of a change. So we can consider it to be constant at 41 degree for a long, long time. This shows that the difference between the temperature of the vacuum insulated panel, which is T1, and the ambient temperature is very less than 2 degrees Celsius. So thus, our assumption that radiation is negligible is also proved here. Next, we find a relation between T2 and T3 using steady state equation, where we take the resistance of the styrofoam layer. And because the dry ice is sublimating, we need a Nusselt number correlation for convection taking part in that cavity, which turns out to be this, which helps us in finding the heat transfer coefficient H. Using this heat transfer coefficient, we find out the rate of convection, and which in turn can be used in the heat balance equation to find out the rate of change of mass of the dry ice with time. So as you can see, the initial mass of dry ice was around 8 kgs. This is found out using geometry and density values. So we found out that it takes around 35,000 seconds to reduce the mass from around 8 kgs to zero, which turns out to be our first phase answer, the first answer. Next, we move to the second phase. While analyzing T2 and T3, we found out that the temperatures almost become constant after around 35,000 seconds. So we can consider both of them constant at around 310 Kelvin. So using this assumption, we calculate T4, which is the temperature of the inner styrofoam layer. And we found out that the temperature shoots to 310 Kelvin in a very less time. And it doesn't increase after that because it almost reaches the ambient temperature. So using these assumptions, we found out that the whole model can be used as a lumped capacitance model to find a relation between T5 and T infinity, which is the ambient temperature. So once again, because the entire chamber of dry ice is filled with carbon dioxide, we need a new Nusselt number correlation for using that for a rectangular cavity. So this is the Nusselt number correlation, which gives us the H convective rate for that part. So using H convective rate and the other resistances of each layer, we find out the equivalent resistance, which is U, which in turn gives us the Biot number and the Fourier number using tables. So we can use these two values in the final equation, which is for calculation of T5 with respect to time. So we get this graph, which is the change of temperature of vaccine with respect to time. So the graph shows us that the temperature changes from around minus 80 degrees Celsius to minus 60 degrees Celsius in around 31,000 seconds, which is the second part of our answer. So we can finally conclude that the total time required for the vaccine to reduce from minus 80 to minus 60 using the coolant as dry ice is nearly 18.55 hours. This can easily aid last mile connectivity for the vaccines, and our product VacBox is thus can be deemed successful. The vaccine such as Pfizer, which requires such low temperatures, can also be transported even in summers where there are high ambient temperatures like 43 degrees Celsius. Using our model, the vaccine will remain undamaged for 18 plus hours without any external cooling source. So once we found out the calculation, what can be done further? So we can conduct transient thermal simulations using a 3D model to get a better idea of how the real scenario will look like. We can also try modeling the dry ice in the form of pellets instead of a single slab. This we came across in some literature. And the inner walls of the vaccine box can be made cylindrical to reduce further heat transfer of heat. This can be done during 3D simulations because in 1D mode, it will be similar to that of a rectangle. Thank you.